Welcome to Watkins United Methodist Church in Louisville, Kentucky. We regret not being together in person, but we rejoice that we can join together virtually. If you're watching live via Facebook and live outside of Louisville, please chat a quick word and let us know where you are. We routinely have a viewer in Hawaii. Maybe you live even further away. Regardless, we'd like to know where you are. And we thank you that are thankful you've tuned in, either live or later via YouTube. I am not Pastor Rob Tucker. He is in his home state of Florida to conduct a cousin's wedding and is due back Tuesday. And I'm not the cleanup batter. Rob doesn't need one. His sermons on stewardship the last 3 weeks have been excellent. I hope I can do as well. I am David Moose, a retired elder from the United Methodist Conference in Arkansas, and I appreciate the opportunity and challenge of bringing God's word to you today. I covet your prayers of support as we proceed, and I appreciate the others who are leading in worship today. One disclaimer, a few of you may recognize my sermon title when we get to it, or even remember a few words from a sermon I delivered here July 13th, 2014. You may remember, but I doubt it. And even if you do, that's okay. Think of it not as a repeat, but as a much needed encore. And with that, let us share responsively in our call to worship. Praise and thanksgiving are due to God this day. Let us glorify our God together. God has led us in the wilderness with manna. God has led us to this time of plenty and promise. The year is crowned with God's bounty. We have received abundance to be shared.
God visits the earth and waters it. God scatters blessings to nourish the poor.
Surely God is touching and healing us. Give thanks that we are called to God's service.
God will direct us in new ways of living. God will confirm us in our covenant in Christ.
Our opening hymn is over 400 years old and comes from the Netherlands. It was not written to be a Thanksgiving hymn, but for it, us, it is very appropriate. Sandra and Ellen will lead us now. I hope you can sing along.
I was up here without my microphone, so you wouldn't be able to hear me. I am not Megan Romero. She is not here with in the church with us today. She's under the weather and not sharing. So I am her substitute today. And she asked me to get a small bag of Skittles. And I guess compared to, I don't know, a bag of flour, this is a small bag of Skittles. But this is what Megan asked me to share with you today, is how we can remember what to pray about, how we can be reminded of the importance of prayer and the topics of prayer that we need to work on. When you pick out an orange Skittle, pray a prayer of thanks to God for everything He has given you, your family, your friends, your church, your food, clothes, shelter, toys, and anything else you are thankful for. For a yellow one, pray for someone in your life you are thankful for by their name. Use their name in your prayer. Pray specifically for that person that God would bless them. If they don't know Jesus as their Savior, pray that God would help you tell them how much Jesus loves them. For a green one, pray and ask God to show you how you can give to others this holiday season. Pray that God would show you someone you can help out by spending time with them or giving them what they need. For purple, pray for those who may not have food or family to spend time with this Thanksgiving. Pray that God would comfort them and provide them with food, with people in their life to show them love. Red Skittles. Pray that as Christmas season begins after Thanksgiving, people would remember that Jesus is the reason we celebrate. Pray that people who don't know Jesus as their Savior will come to know Jesus as their Savior this Christmas. Enjoy your Skittles. Now, thank you very much.
Thank you, Kathy. In personal concerns, this past week saw the passing of one of our faithful church members, Norm Ward. Please keep Barb and her family in your prayers. And also those that you know of who have special needs. A word of celebration this past week, yesterday, saw the collection of numerous food items, 16,281 items of food to help feed those in need. This is from our scout troops 308 and 309, church members here from Watkins and from St. Benedict, and perhaps others of you. We appreciate all that you have done. Part of worship is offering, of course, and we appreciate your continued faithfulness in that area by check, cash, credit card, however. And also we appreciate those who have returned their pledge cards. If you have not yet, you can still do that. This is an important part of the church's planning and support as we continue in our many ministries. I invite you now to be in an attitude of prayer. Holy God, with thankfulness we turn our thoughts and voices to you. You are the giver of every good and perfect gift, and we are the recipients of your generosity. In this joyous season that calls to mind your mercy, kindness, and eternal providence, we give you thanks. Our blessings are very great, even in the midst of a terrible pandemic. We pray your comforting presence to all who suffer and grieve due to loss and confinement, and to all who diligently serve those who are in need. Give us, we pray, eyes to see all that you have done for us and hearts fully appreciative. We believe, Lord, that to whom much is given, much is required. Help us to fulfill the obligations that our riches place upon us. Help us to share abundantly, but wisely and with utmost discretion, with those who have too little, whether they are of our own kind and country or of different languages in distant lands. Let us not be satisfied to sit down at our well-filled tables on Thanksgiving Day until we have given substantial help to those in need. We thank you most of all, O God, for the enduring riches which have come to us through our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, the forgiveness of sins, the indwelling of the Holy Spirit, the resurrection of the dead, and the life everlasting. May we follow Jesus in the full assurance of his strength and guidance. And it is in his holy name we ask. Amen. Henry Smith Jr. wrote almost 300 hymns, but only one was published. And it's a great one, particularly appropriate for this season of Thanksgiving. It reflects the Bible verse which tells us that Jesus, though he was rich, became poor for our sakes. Gary and Ellen will lead us, and I hope that you can sing along. I'll give thanks.
Good morning. You will hear the first verse twice, and then we'll do the second verse twice.
Sections of scripture with you today from the gospel according to Luke chapter 6, just this one verse, 38. Give to others and God will give to you. Indeed, you will receive a full measure, a generous helping poured into your hands, all that you can hold. The measure you use for others is the measure that God will use for you. And from 2 Corinthians chapter 9, and again, this is today's English version, commonly called the Good News Bible, so it may be a little different from one you might be reading now, but it's the same message. Remember that a person who plants few seeds will have a small crop. The one who plants many seeds will have a large crop. Each one should give them as he or she has decided, not with regret or out of a sense of duty. For God loves the one who gives gladly. And God is able to give you more than you need, so that you will always have all you need for yourselves and more than enough for every good cause. As the scripture says, he gives generously to the needy. His kindness lasts forever. And God, who supplies seed for the sower and bread to eat, will support you with all the seed you need and will make it grow and produce a rich harvest from your generosity. He will always make you rich enough to be generous. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Those who regularly watch this service will know that I'm behind the pulpit. That's because I'm old school and I'm a manuscript preacher. And it's easier to handle things from up here. Leaving church one Sunday morning, a young boy said to the pastor, "When I grow up and have a job, I'm going to give you half of all my money." "Well, Jason," replied the stunned pastor, that's very thoughtful of you, but why would you give me half of all your money?" And quickly came the reply, "Because my daddy says you're the poorest preacher we've ever had." Words like poor and rich and money and ministry can have vastly different meanings, but we need to talk about them anyway. So here we go, starting with three progressive questions. Are you rich? Are you rich enough? Are you rich enough to be generous? Back in the days when evening TV was safe for the whole family to watch, an episode of The Cosby Show involved teenage daughter Vanessa complaining about being snubbed by her classmates because she was rich. Claire Huxtable, the mother, makes this corrective statement. "Honey, we're not rich. Being rich is when your money works for you. Not being rich is when you work for your money. And we work hard for our money." By that definition, most of us are not rich. Can I get an amen? But there are other definitions. By world standards, we are rich. If we have enough food to eat and a safe place to sleep, we're rich. If we have indoor plumbing, we're rich. If we own a television, I think Judy and I own three of them, we're rich. And if we actually own a car or a truck or both, wow, we're doing great. We're filthy rich. But I don't want to talk about world standards. Because we're Christians, our standards are not primarily secular or financial. They're biblical. So what does God's word have to say? The Bible, which so often challenges our value systems and our way of thinking, declares that God is making us rich, rich enough, rich enough to be generous. In our text from 2 Corinthians chapter 9, the Apostle Paul quotes from Psalm 112, "God gives generously to the needy. His kindness lasts forever." Paul then personalizes the point for his Corinthian readers by adding, "God who supplies seed for the sower and bread to eat will also supply you with all the seed you need and will make it grow and produce a rich harvest from your generosity. He will always make you rich enough to be generous." Part of the message here, I believe, is that being rich enough to be generous is not a matter of what's in your bank, your pocket, or your purse. It's a matter of what's in your heart and in your head. It's attitude. Simply put, generosity grows out of gratitude. For Christians and many others, gratitude is a natural everyday motivation because we know that every blessing, material and spiritual, is a gift from God. Now, the matter does not end here, nor will my sermon, lest I get in trouble for not preaching long enough. I know how you hate short sermons. In verse 6, perhaps quoting a proverb well known to his audience, Paul writes, "Remember the saying, meager sowing, meager harvest. Plentiful sowing, plentiful harvest." Farmers certainly know this truth. I hope we all know this truth. It applies not only in nature, but also in human relationships. Most of the time, what we give is what we get. If I wanted to get personal, I could illustrate this point with the faithfulness of some of you listening to me right now. You perform quiet acts of kindness and contribute to various ministries locally and globally without expecting anything in return. But in return, you are blessed. Is that what Jesus is saying in Luke 6, verse 38? "Give, and it will be given to you. A good measure, pressed down, shaken together, running over, will be put into your lap." The measure you give, the measure is the measure you will get back. Allow me to witness to this in my own life, even though it's a little embarrassing to admit that in our early married years of scraping just to get by, Judy and I were not good tithers. That is, giving back to God 10% of what we took in. Then when all three of our children were in college at the same time, we committed to regular tithing, not being sure if we could still pay our bills. The result? Well, I can't explain it completely, but ever since then, we have been better off financially. Maybe it's simply an expression of Malachi chapter 3, which says, "Bring the full tithe into the storehouse, says the Lord of hosts. See if I will not open the windows of heaven for you and pour down on you an overflowing blessing." If you're not presently tithing, I encourage you to tithe, or at least thank God with an increased portion of what you take in. But a word of warning here. If we think of this as an automatic quid pro quo, one thing in return for another, we may fall into the trap of doing the right thing for the wrong reason. Years ago, I was discussing tithing with a non-Methodist preacher friend, and he told me, quote, "I give God 10% of my income because if I don't, I'll be punished, and if I do, I'll be rewarded." Well, I have a problem with that attitude. Maybe it's a subtle difference, and maybe the real motivation can only be known within the heart of the giver. But I don't think that's grateful giving. I think that's calculated giving. And I don't think it's biblical. I believe why we give is more important than what we give. Whether we give a lot or a little. Let me tell you about Veda Ulmer. She was one of God's poor people living in western Arkansas, just below Fort Smith and near Hackett, a small community where I pastored many years ago. In a land of affluence and comfort, Veda Elmer drew her water from a well because her home never had inside plumbing. She lit her home with candles because she had no electricity and could not afford to have it installed. When she would come into town, she walked because she had no car. As far as I knew, Veda was never was not a member of any particular church, but periodically she would surprise us by sending $5 $1 bills to the Hackett United Methodist Church because she believed in the ministries done by that congregation and because she was afflicted with a generous spirit. With an attitude of gratitude, one can be generous on very little. Isn't that the message Jesus made when he told about the poor widow who put in 2 small copper coins worth only a penny? In Mark 12 and Luke 21, Jesus says, "Truly, I tell you, this poor widow has put in more than all the rich people, for all of them have contributed out of their abundance, but she out of her poverty." One can be generous on very little or with very much. It's all relative, as are the church's connectional ministries, what we used to call apportionments. Other churches have other names for it. Watkins' share this next year is $24,450. The amounts are always relative to the size and strength of the church. What varies is the attitude and thus the giving of the church. As a United Methodist pastor in Arkansas many years, I had 16 appointments and special assignments involving 24 different congregations. In size, they ranged from the largest church in the conference, where I was an associate pastor, to one congregation so small that the average worship attendance could have fit in our Honda Accord. Each of those congregations, large and small, was able to pay its connectional fair share. I believe that this church as well can, because what it's asked to give, as I said, is relative to its size and strength. And the Bible says, God will always make us, what? Rich enough to be generous. Will it be easy? Probably not. Will the budget need to be adjusted? Ours already has been. But can it be done? To quote Rocky Balboa, absolutely. I mentioned being involved in different conference ministries in Arkansas. At different times, I was conference youth coordinator, secretary to the Conference Council of Ministries, chair of the Board of Diaconal Ministry, a longtime member of the Board of Ordained Ministry, etc. One experience from all of those experiences, one that I wish I could transfer to you through a Vulcan mind melt, however they do that, is seeing how conscientiously those church agencies worked to perform their assigned duties and to stretch their available dollars. Dollars available only because of faithful people like you. I don't know specific figures for the Kentucky annual conference, but I know it involves hundreds of ministries and thousands of people, locally and globally. And every church has its own assigned share. If you want to know what is your personal share, well, for that we need to go back to the Bible. The Bible, both the Old Testament and New Testament, calls on us to give at least 10% of our wherewithal to the work of God. And to give it joyfully, not grudgingly, not with regret, not out of a sense of duty, not shamed into it by social pressure, but freely, joyfully, gratefully, with thanksgiving. Now you may be thinking, okay, but we don't have much to give. What then? Or you may be thinking, I wish I had more to give. What then? Well, over 250 years ago, John Wesley, the founder of the Methodist movement, had some excellent advice. Earn all you can, save all you can, and give all you can. If you're part of Watkins, that should sound really familiar following Pastor Rob's insightful sermons over the last 3 weeks. Earn all you can, doing honest, moral work. Wesley disapproved of selling alcohol or owning slaves. Are you retired? I thought I was, but this spring I heard an appeal for 2020 census workers to go door to door to interview people who did not return their own census information. So I signed up to do a community service. But during the 2 months that I worked, I earned over $7,000. You may be permanently retired or not. You may still be working. Invest wisely. That's another way to earn. But to give all you can, you need, first of all, to save all you can. Is this a challenge for you? There are 1,000 ways to save money. This past year, I decided to save money by not going to the barbershop anymore. Judy and I don't eat out very often. Now, here are some other quick examples from a trip we took to attend a Lions Club International Convention in Toronto, Canada. First, for breakfast, you know, some folks eat in the hotel restaurant or even order room service for $20 or $30 or $40 or more. On average, the two of us spent $3 a day for breakfast. $3 a day for breakfast for the two of us. How do we do that? By buying a box of cereal and a quart of milk at a nearby grocery store and eating in the room, which fortunately came with a refrigerator and a coffee maker. Two, convention cafes are very high priced, so we usually ate peanut butter crackers and an apple for lunch. Three, since restaurant set servings are so large, we split our evening meals and always had plenty to eat. Four, we resisted the temptation to spend a lot of money on souvenirs, dust collectors, we call them. And finally, in driving back home, we filled up the gas tank before we got to Jefferson County. And if you live here, you know what that means. By attending the convention, we spent a lot of money on gas, registration, housing, but we also, by being careful, saved a lot of money, which we were able to give to church and charity. There are 1,000 ways to save more so that we can give more. Earn all you can, save all you can, so you're able to give all you can. I doubt that folks in first century Corinth were very wealthy, but Paul tells them and us, God is able to meet our needs so fully that we have enough to share with others. He made each of us, what? Rich enough to be generous. Early in the 13th century in Italy, Giovanni Francesco Bernardone, better known to us as St. Francis of Assisi, with only a crust of bread to eat at the end of a toilsome day, shared his bread with another monk. Francis, looking out over a beautiful Italian landscape, cried out, "Oh, my brother, we are not worthy of such a vast treasure." This little brother of the poor, like Mother Teresa centuries later, had abundance to share, his open hand motivated by an open heart. So one more time, are you rich? Are you rich enough? Are you rich enough to be generous? I hope your answers are yes, yes, and yes, because I believe God blesses our yeses. In the name of God, the creative provider, God, the soul saver, and God, the generous spirit. Amen. Gary and Ellen will lead us in our closing song. Again, we hope that you can sing along.
All to Jesus I surrender, all to Him I freely give. I will ever love and trust Him, in His presence daily live. I surrender all, I surrender all to Thee, my blessed Savior, I surrender all. All to Jesus I surrender, humbly at His feet I bow. Worldly pleasures all forsaken, take me, Jesus, take me now. I surrender all, I surrender all. All to Thee, my blessed Savior, I surrender all. All to Jesus I surrender, make me Savior, wholly Thine. Let me feel the Holy Spirit, truly know that Thou art mine. I surrender all, I surrender all. All to Thee, my blessed Savior, I surrender all. All to Jesus I surrender, Lord, I give myself to Thee. Fill me with Thy love and power, let Thy blessing fall on me. I surrender all, I surrender all. All to Thee, my blessed Savior, I surrender all. All to Jesus I surrender, now I feel the sacred flame. Oh, the joy of full salvation, glory, glory to His name. I surrender all, I surrender all. All to Thee, my blessed Savior, I surrender all.
Amen. Thank you, Gary and Ellen. We're concluding a little bit early today, and so I want to add a note before the benediction. One ministry of this congregation, as with many others, is support of refugees who come to this country seeking a better life and escaping from danger and even death in their home countries. Recently, this congregation has co-sponsored two families. They both are from the Congo. Most recently is a mother and her 21-year-old son. We work through Kentucky Refugee Ministries, particularly with Maha Kolko, who's the caseworker, and we have received a certificate of appreciation from Kentucky Refugee Ministries. I hope that in an upcoming Sunday, Maha can be here in person and can tell us a bit more about the families, the individuals whom we have assisted. I appreciate those of you who have contributed to make this possible, and to the members of the Refugee Task Force who have paid special attention to the need of some of God's less fortunate people. And now, may you go from this time of focused worship back into your world of service. May you celebrate with thanksgiving God's goodness. May you share his love with those around you. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.